governments were not coming on board. It is as if the governments were not prepared to come on board based on a request from radical community organizations. And recognizing that fact, those of us in academia, and the universities especially, we got together and we crafted an inter-university academic discourse, and that was the conversation we placed before the governments. And lo and behold, the governments responded to that. It was as if it was easier for them to say, yes, the academic community has spoken, and we, the governments, will respond to this. They responded to the academics. They did not respond to the grassroots organizations. And it's important to recognize that, why that is the case. I will not go into the details of that, but you can very well understand the nature of politics. It isn't that the academic community had more persuasive power. It is just the nature of how governments function in this liberal age. And so the CARICOM Commission developed a document, as you have heard from Ron, what we call the 10-point plan. The key to our movement was to associate reparatory justice with the development of the Caribbean peoples, with the development of the Caribbean economy, the development of Caribbean communities, citizens, and institutions. The public opinion had been divided all along because the anti-reparations argument has had its impact upon public opinion. Those who are opposed to reparations are absolutely ingenious in finding arguments to deflect away the integrity of the truth. And so you have to find strategies to counter all of that. And so we assembled a team and we said, what are the primary developmental challenges facing the Caribbean economy today? We recognize that the Europeans have left a horrible colonial mess in the Caribbean. After 300 years of exploitation, most of the countries became independent, and at the moment of independence, when we took responsibility for ourselves, we inherited a tremendous mess that we have been trying to clean up ever since. And you cannot clean up a 400-year-old mess by yourself. And that really became the critical issue, and so we looked at development. How we are going to get these economies competitive, how we are going to build institutions for community advancement, how we are going to eradicate illiteracy, how we are going to promote public health. You heard Nana spoke about diabetes and hypertension, the chronic disease epidemic, which is ripping through the black community. And if you take the simple marker of chronic diseases, hypertension, diabetes especially, then the black folks in the Caribbean are the sickest people in the world because we have the highest proportion in the world of hypertension, diabetes in our black community. And it has to do with the fact that the slavery culture started in the Caribbean and was its most vicious in those islands. And we can speak to that because we have the facts, which is why we speak of genocide.
That's right.
The British brought 6 million African people into the Caribbean. At the end of emancipation, there were 1.5 million remaining. How do you move from 6 million to 1.5 million after 200 years? Genocide. It was impossible to live as an African person to survive in the Caribbean in that slavery process. And so we speak of genocide in the Caribbean context because only 18% of all the Africans who came into the Caribbean survived through that emancipation period. It's a horrendous attrition of human life. And so we developed a 10-point plan that focused on the development agenda. And somehow governments felt, now we can talk to this. Governments felt we can relate to this because the anti-reparations propaganda was that black folks wanted to stand around on street corners expecting handouts. That we were going to stand on the street corners and white folks were going to give us money. And that was the language which you have heard, which we have had to deal with, all of that propaganda. We said, no. Reparations is about the development of Caribbean peoples who you have underdeveloped and exploited for 400 years. And so The first point in our 10-point plan was the apology. That was absolutely critical, necessary. They refused to do it. We insist upon it. Then we focus on the repatriation. You've heard, especially the Rastafari people who have always defined themselves as stolen people with a right to return to the source of their homes. Then we spoke about African Knowledge Network, where African children have a right to travel to Africa, to have school exchanges, and so on. I attended high school in Britain. Every summer, the kids at my school were taken to some place in Europe for cultural induction. And so we were taken to Rome and to Greece to see the antecedents of Western culture. Black kids in this part of the world have a right to be put on an airplane and taken to Africa to pair with other schools and so on and have school exchanges. Why can't we have that? All the white kids in Europe have that. And that was funded through our labor. So we want to have an African Knowledge Network system. Illiteracy eradication is important to us. The British left 80% of all the black folks in the Caribbean illiterate. You leave 80% of all the folks in a society illiterate, you give them their independence and you say, go and develop. How do you develop an economy with 80% illiteracy? And you don't build schools, you don't build colleges. I am the president, yes, of the University of the West Indies. The British government in 1948 gave the governments of the Caribbean £350,000 to start a college. And it was called the University College of London, UWI, Caribbean. A small amount of money to build a single little college, two buildings. That was their gift to the Caribbean after 300 years. Two buildings. Two buildings and a program in medicine. Well, this is now 60, 70 years later. We now have a campus with 80, we have three campuses with 85,000 students. We now have one of the largest universities in the world. But that was not British generosity. That was Caribbean people helping themselves. And so we have said, we do not see reparations as handouts. You have to make a contribution. And after you have made a contribution, you leave the rest to us. In other words, we don't want gifts. You make your contribution and leave the rest to us. But you can't walk away from this mess.
That's right.
You come back, make a contribution, and leave the rest to us. So we spoke of health initiatives, psychological rehabilitation, technology transfer. You know, the African people brought all kinds of technology into this part of the world. Built their economies, built their urban developments, built their tropical agricultural system, technology. They brought all of that technology out of Africa, and now we are left without that technology.
That's right.
They owe it to us to bring that technology back. So we speak about technology transfer and, of course, land reform. On my island of Barbados, where I was born, in slavery, well, they owned all the land. To this very day, a small percentage of the white community, 3% of the island's population, owns 80% of all the arable land. 3% of the island's population owns 80% of the arable land because no one has taken it upon themselves to look at the issue of the land redistribution as a right of the African peoples. But these are things that we have spoken about. So our 10-point plan focuses upon all of these issues. And finally, the 10-point, debt cancellation.
Yeah.
Why debt cancellation? Let me tell you. One of the main reasons why Caribbean governments are all faced with a horrendous fiscal deficit is because the only way they could treat with this colonial mess they have inherited is to spend more than they earn. They have to spend on health, they have to spend on education, they have to spend on public infrastructure, and the fact is these economies do not have the competitive advantage to generate the revenue to support a modern life.
Right.
You cannot support a modern life. Governments overextend themselves to invest, to give their citizens a decent living. Therein lies the foundation of this fiscal challenge which is facing Caribbean economies, the issue of indebtedness. You borrow to invest in your citizens. I know this more than anyone. because the University of the West Indies is a highly reputable international university. We are known all over the world. We have produced 4 Nobel laureates. We are a highly distinguished university. But how do you maintain a first-class, globally respected university in a poor, underperforming economic structure? It becomes extremely difficult indeed, but we do it. And the governments oftentimes extend themselves by making investments, and oftentimes they borrow when they know they should not be doing it, but they have to maintain standards while they are proceeding with democracy. And so debt cancellation is very important to us. Now, the strategy we have adopted is then to ask our governments to prepare what the lawyers call, Charles, I'm not sure if you call it the same thing, but in British common law, it's called the letter of complaint. So we have now drafted this letter of complaint with our lawyers. The letter of complaint will be presented to the governments of Britain and Europe. And this letter of complaint is a formal official statement that says, and whereas after 400 years of slavery, colonization, and genocide, the people of African descent continue to suffer these injustices, we want to have a summit to discuss the consequences. The letter of complaint is drafted. It is now before the prime ministers of the Caribbean. We are now in a state of waiting, with bated breath, for our prime ministers now to submit this letter to the governments of Europe. Now, the choice before the governments is clear, 2 choices. We could have proceeded to the International Court of Justice with our claim. There is a path to go that way. Our lawyers have advised us not to take that path, but in the first instance to take the path of diplomacy, which is to call upon the European governments for a summit to discuss these matters. That is, in much the same way that we had a summit or many summits in the 60s to discuss the end of colonization and the beginning of independence, let us now also have a major summit to discuss reparatory justice. That is the approach which the governments have adopted, and it is based upon an important legal procedure. The British government has very skillfully, in its own kind of way, instructed its judiciary that any case coming before it, before the courts, dealing with colonial crimes before 1950 cannot and must not be heard. So any case that comes before the British courts of a reparatory nature in respect of any crime that has been committed in the colonial period before 1950, the courts will not hear these cases. It was an incredible technicality that allowed the Mau Mau case to be heard last year when the crimes were committed in the 1940s. The technicality was that when the case was being prepared, suddenly the documents illustrating British government atrocities against the Kenyan people, the torture, the brutality, the imprisonment, and remember, Britain had just prosecuted the Nazis for the same offenses. Yeah. Britain is now doing the same thing to the Africans in Kenya. The documents disappeared. The documents that were public records in the public records office speaking to these issues disappeared. The judge had no choice but to say this is a case of tampering with the evidence, and the judge says let the case be heard, because it was state tampering with the evidence. And so, of course, the government decided the case will not be heard, we will settle out of court. And that is how that matter was dealt with. So, we were told by our lawyers that the way forward is through the CERT. That's an acronym, that's the Convention for the Elimination of Racial Discrimination. All of those countries in the world that have signed up to the Convention for the Elimination of Racial Discrimination have to demonstrate systematically that they have taken steps to do so. The British government, like most Caribbean governments, have signed up to the survey. Our lawyers believe that they can make a very clear case that Britain has refused to honor its commitment under the CERT, and we can put them before the tribunal in the CERT for a reparatory justice matter. So that's the path that has been recognized by our attorneys in the first instance to pursue the issue of reparatory justice. Finally, we do not believe in the Caribbean that because we have a CARICOM commission, a government-owned and funded commission, that we in civil society ought to abandon our struggle. 200 years of civil society struggle, our governments have finally come on board. And we are appreciative of that. The fact that the governments have come on board have strengthened the case, because in this instance, we are looking at a path to reparations as a government-to-government negotiation. Government-to-government negotiation. So the governments have come on board. But governments are always fickle. And we have to be mindful of that. And I speak as the chairman of a government commission. The government could change their minds tomorrow. And if they do, where does that leave us in civil society? Those of us in civil society, we must keep the struggle going. We must keep going and going. So in the Caribbean, we have determined that while our governments are going to make up their minds, whether they will send forward that letter of complaint to the governments of Europe to trigger the summit on reparatory justice, we will continue. One of the things that we are planning to do in the early part of next year, and working with our colleagues in the American, and by the way, let me say, when you have chosen to adjust HR 40 to HR 40B, we were hoping that you would have called that HR 40A. HR 40A for America, HR 40B for Brazil, HR 40C for the Caribbean. So, John, we see our struggle as HR 40C. So all of the things that we're doing, this is HR 40C for Caribbean, and this is where we're going. So we are going to plan a reparations rally from one end of the Caribbean to the next. And we're going to call it the 1 Million Woman March. Because they're going to start in Florida with the Americans Commission, or New York. We will go through the Bahamas, Jamaica, Antigua, Barbuda, all the way down, and we're going to focus international opinion on this inter-community rally to focus the world's view. And we're going to identify with the women in this march, in this rally, because of what we know about what they did to our people. Slavery, chattel slavery, focused on the female. Mm. It was a black woman who was at the center of this. She was targeted. Slavery was passed on through the black female. It wasn't passed on through the black male. The black male could have a child with a white woman. That child was born free, because a white woman could not give birth to a slave. So in our archives in the Caribbean, we have dozens of cases of enslaved men having children with white women. And those children were born free, because the laws are very clear. A white woman cannot give birth to a slave child. But the child of a black woman, irrespective of the father, whether the father was white or the father was black, free or enslaved, that child was born into slavery, because the black woman was the carrier of slavery. And therefore she was focused specifically for the reproduction of the slavery line. And this is why the slavery laws were written the way they were, to protect the white male slave owner, so he could have his sexual freedom and manipulation and rape and pillage of black women. And those children were born as his property. They were, had no claim to freedom. They were his property. They could not make a claim on his property. His property were the reserve of his white children. And therefore, his black and colored offspring had no claim on his property. And this is precisely why the black woman was targeted as the reproducer of the status of slavery. And so we know, as historians, that the system of enslavement targeted the black woman in ways it did not target the black male, and that she had a more vicious and brutal exploitation in slavery than the black male. I don't wish to get into fine details, but let me say this. The black female, look at what was actually enslaved. It wasn't just her labor that was enslaved. It was her fertility. It was her maternity instincts. It was her procreational capacity. So slavery penetrated her body beyond labor. It penetrated her body and it commodified her reproductive capacity. That is what was commodified. And therefore, the experience of a black woman in slavery was fundamentally different in many ways from a black male. Because with the female, she was at the center of how it was reproduced generation after generation after generation. So we are going to organize the Million Woman Rally that will highlight all of these things I have mentioned to you, the historical issues. And we are going to sit back and we are going to watch how the world responds to this. Because we know that many of those countries in Europe, their position is, they are quite ready and prepared to discuss this matter. And what they have said to us in some places, we are ready to discuss, but we do not wish to be ashamed in the process. And this is a decision that we cannot make. The French government has said, we have established a reputation for global diplomacy, progressive thought, liberalism. We are a civilized culture that specializes in the art of diplomacy. But they do not wish to be embarrassed to speak about the economics of slavery. The British government is now promoting a culture of anti-terrorism, democracy, justice, and liberty, and so they should. They do not wish to have broadcast to the whole world the issues of the terrorism against African people, the brutality and the terrorism, because the evidence will have to be placed on the table. I am currently preparing a book on systems of torture used against African peoples. Systems of torture. So far, I have identified 2,000 systems, 2,000 methods created out of the European imagination of how to terrorize African peoples. So the ones that you know, the burning the oil, the dismemberment, the imprisonment, those are just the few that are well known. But they were extremely creative in the design of systems of terrorism. And we need to put all of this evidence on the table. This is an evidentiary basis of terrorism that have been imposed upon our people for 300 years. And so we are aware that they might not wish to go into a tribunal or a court to discuss these matters.
That's right.
And at some stage, and this is not going to go away. By the way, the British government is hoping that, you know, the next generation of youth, that we are the old folks who are in the leadership of this movement, but the younger folks are not here. And they're hoping that we will all die off, and when we die out, the movement will die with us. That's their strategy. That's their strategy. So they are sitting us out, and the longer they could procrastinate, the better it will be for them. But it doesn't work like that. There are lots of young kids all over the black world who are just waiting to step up to the plate. So, in the next couple of months, we are going to establish at the University of the West Indies an Institute for Reparation Studies. Because the governments, asked us to do this. When the commission was established, the remit given to us in the university was to establish an Institute for Reparation Studies as a global network of scholars. a global network of scholars who are committed to reparatory justice conversations, and we are going to establish this institute in the next couple of months. So this is where we are, friends. This is where we are with the Caribbean process. We are now waiting on our governments to take this bold step. We are waiting on them, and we are encouraging them to move collectively, decisively. We believe that the work has been done. The lawyers have done their work. The community organizations have done their work. The grassroots have done their work. The commission has done its work. But now we are waiting for our governments now to make that formal letter of complaint lodged to the governments of Europe so that we can take the next step. I thank you.